If a man dedicates his life to good deeds and the welfare of others, he will die unthanked and unremembered. If he exercises his genius, bringing misery and death to billions, his name will echo through the millennia for 100 lifetimes. Infamy is always more preferable to ignominy. The warriors of the Astartes incur grievous injuries, both physical and mental in nature. Wading through the obscene violence, unbearable torment, and the enticements of thirsting gods, even those blessed by the Emperor's gifts can bleed and require attending by those blessed with the methods of healing and repairing his angel's wounds. Yet many healers charged with the safety and health of the Space Marines have forsworn their oaths to safekeep their brethren, and armed with knowledge and insatiable curiosity, have eschewed their duty to the Master of Mankind in order to pursue their own experiments. For today, we shall elucidate the tale of a genius mind, corrupted not by the machinations of the Immaterium, but rather the unquenchable thirst for innovation, with no regard for ethics. A renegade known far and wide across the stars as Clone Lord, Primogenitor, and even the Spider, Fabius Bile. With the birth of the nascent Imperium during the heady days of the 30th millennium, a new era dawned for humanity. The Emperor, ruler of the crucible of mankind's origin world, had waged his wars of unification across the war-torn surface of Terra. His armies never faltering in their purge of those who would deny the vision of a united species. Among the first continents of old Earth, Northern Europa would pledge its fealty to the new ruler of the throne world. The aristocracy tithing their sons to be drafted into the genesis of a new breed of warriors, among the minor noble house of Ingolstadt, a boy of unfathomable promise would be assigned as an aspirant of the Third Legion. Bearing a voracious appetite for knowledge, the young blonde-haired, purple-eyed youth spent much of his time listening to music within the library of his household, reading from leather-bound books, learning basic arts of fleshcrafting from servants of his family's court. Little would anyone know that the boy modifying the behavior of mice to duel one another in fights to the death would one day craft beings of absolute cruelty and purpose. Following the blight of their gene seed, whittling the Legion's numbers to only 200 surviving Astartes, the Space Marine known as Fabius would be thrust into a position of prominence under the stewardship of Legion Master Fralas. Appointed as an apothecary of the Legion, due to all others of superior skill and seniority perishing due to the sabotage conducted by the Selenar gene cults of Luna. Seeking a means to remove the taint of the blight from his Terran kin and even his own body, Fabius toiled relentlessly and would earn the nickname Spider from his peers. Taking samples from his cancer-riddled fallen kin, the fate of those proven imperfect due to their infection would be punishable by death, and as such the Spider of the Third Legion switched a sample of his flesh with a fellow healthy battle brother as an act of misdirection. Buying time to find a means of a cure, as Bile gathered samples of those taken by the Blight, all hope of deliverance from his fate was not forthcoming. Meeting with his reunited Primarch, Fulgrim, upon the mining world of Chemos, Fabius would soon earn praise from his gene sire due to his efforts to ensure the Legion's survival. Promoted to the rank of Chief Apothecary as the Great Crusade continued and the Legion began to burgeon, the Chemosian recruits which swelled their number were bereft of the Blight. Soon the Terrans of the Legion would diminish to the point where only a handful carried its deadly imprint within their gene coding. Fabius still struggled to contain the deadly curse within his bloodstream, yet for his veterancy and faultless service made in the name of his Legion, his Primarch entrusted more power to his favored son. Given the rank of Lieutenant Commander of the Emperor's Children, Fabius now held a position to lead thousands of his subordinate battle brothers as among the most powerful Space Marines, not just within his Legion, but the entirety of the Legiones Astartes. Yet even this prestigious pedigree would pale in his duty to unearth new discoveries and epiphanies when wielding his surgeon scalpel. His men were not comrades nor kinsmen in Fabius's eyes. They were little more than specimens to dissect and improve. Mere notes in a symphony he would one day complete. Ambition had stirred within the chief apothecary's heart, for such was his ambition that he sought to one day surpass the Emperor's own genius, yet to openly announce such hubris would earn the spider of the Third Legion only censure and ignominy. Soon, however, a chance to test his genius, unfettered by the Imperium's oversight, would present itself, and Fabius would not allow such an opportunity to go to waste. Upon the world of Laren, the Emperor's children began their path to damnation. Purging the ocean world of native Xenos frets, within a temple devoted to the ruinous powers, the Phoenician found upon the Blade of the Lair. Within its confines, the strange weapon bore a malign entity of the warp, and with time whispered deceptions into the mind of Fulgrim. As the rot set within the Third Legion, Fabius in turn aided their descent into madness as he gleaned insight from the dissection of the Laren Xenos. Modifying his Legion's gene seed with adaptations of the Laren, the species showed signs of intense genetic manipulations through some unknown means, with which Bile found inescapably alluring. Given sanction from his slowly corrupting Primarch to facilitate surgeries among the ranks of the Emperor's children, Fabius's experiments saw to the implantation of vocal cord augmetics upon the arrogant Lord Commander, Eidolon. Proving invaluable during the conflict of the rebellion of Istvan III, Eidolon's sonic scream ripped the war singer of the battlefield's form to shreds as his stalwart subordinate, Captain Saul Tarvitz, looked on in horror. Saving the life of the battle captain of the 14th Legion, Nathaniel Garrow, Bile's actions, though damning his Legion and future generations to their infamous bloody deeds, would also allow for a hero of the Imperium to slip the net. Complicit in his kin's betrayal of the Imperium, following the atrocity of Istvan III, Fabius worked diligently on altering the bodies of his battle brothers. Aiding in the creation of abominations such as the first Noise Marines, Bile's alterations of their nervous systems replaced all feelings of pain with sensations of pleasure. Monsters capable of among the greatest heresies known to man, Bile's first disgusting experiments would be unleashed during the reprisal of the Loyalists upon the soil of Istvan V. Watching in horror as the once proud warriors of the Phoenician faced them in battle, the Iron Hands, Salamanders, and Raven Guard combated the disfigured and despicable scions of She Who Firsts. Bile himself had surmised that only a single year remained of his own struggle with the Blight, yet would never surrender to the whims of profane so-called gods such as Slaanesh. Confessing his affliction to his Primarch, with the blessing of Fulgrim, the Spider had more than earned a reprieve from war to continue his own studies to preserve his life. Leaving his Legion to busy themselves with their endless pursuit of pleasure and vendettas against the Imperium, Fabius could not waste time while the Blight continued to ravage his body. Researching forbidden techniques on genetic engineering sealed within the choral conclaves of Istvan V, his experiments of the chaos-corrupted war singers would provide the first insights to prolong his existence. Exorcising the demon of the Lair Blade from the body of his Primarch, with the Phoenician's faculties returned, Fulgrim had one demand in mind as penance for his leniency. Cloning the Primarch of the Iron Hands, Ferus Manus, using fragments of his corpse, Fulgrim's most cherished brother would be instrumental in winning the civil war should an acceptable clone be converted to their cause. Despite creating dozens of ever more perfected copies of the Gorgon, Fabius regardless failed in his mission to change the indomitable yet fractured mind of these pretender Primarchs. Utilizing his newfound expertise to ever more incredible feats of biological marvels, with the decapitation of the Lord Commander of the Legion, Eidolon, Bile brought the narcissistic commander back from the grave. Depravity ran rampant as the laws of life and death continued to diminish, for Fabius's scalpels and medicinal concoctions defied all conventions of ethics and morality. Torturing captured Space Marines of both sides of the divide of the Civil War, a new breed of warriors would be forged. The Terrata, the first breed of Bile's mission to transcend the human form into the next stage of evolution, while physically stronger, were regardless harried by rampant mutations and mental instability. Their violent outbursts aiding the degenerate Legion during the final battle of the Horus Heresy, the Siege of Terra, did little to help the Emperor's children's flagrant disregard for orders, command, or discipline. As the Third Legion captured civilians of the Administratum, Bile conducted vile experiments of those brought to his surgeon's table, rendering their bodies down into stimulants, intoxicants, and other horrific concoctions. Slaanesh salivated at the sheer decadence facilitated by the mad scientist of Europa. Bile's curiosity and need for answers insatiable, his rejection of the dark gods did little to prevent feeding their own hunger for suffering. As the siege failed to bring about the destruction of the Imperial Palace, the traitors retreated from the throne world with the death of the War Master of Chaos. Fabius took little heed for such a defeat, and despite Fulgrim's proclamation of a bounty for the death of the spider, Bile continued his dark experiments as he plumbed the depths of heresy. Garbed in a suit of artificer armor, flooding his bloodstream with painkillers and powerful stimulants, the demonic entity known as the Chirurgeon inhabits his back-mounted surgeon's tools as it pumps life-enriching ichor through his ancient body. Carrying the Rod of Torment, once belonging to the demon prince, Shalaklak, the Marquis of Mutilation, its merest touch causes its victims to writhe in agony. Armed with a Zyklos Needler, fitted with strange, corrosive, and virulent vile concoctions, the spider continues his endless quest for knowledge by firing untested compounds upon his foes. Forming his own warband and recruiting several orphaned apothecaries of traitor legions to his fold, the self-styled primogenitor clung to a twisted form of the Imperial Truth as the unfolding phenomena of the warp and its denizens continued to corrupt real space. Truth is his championed virtue, with innovation as a close second. For while the Legion Wars erupted within the Eye of Terror, between the fragmented hordes of the War Master's armies, a new opportunity presented itself. Horus Lupercal had failed in bringing about a new age for humanity in service to the Dark Gods, yet Fabius knew that a chance for a renewed continuation of the Civil War could be achieved. Whilst amassing his new men into armies of utterly loyal genetic atrocities to fight at his whim, Fabius constructed vast flesh refineries across the surface of Arden 9. Known by the inhabitants of the system as Manflayer for his practice of stitching a long lab coat from the skin of his enemies, Bile forced such still-living skinless victims to carry the excess of his garment behind him, alike to a grotesque bridal train. His experiments destroyed with the intervention of the Salamander's chapter of the Adeptus Astartes, Bile fled to the confines of the warp rather than suffer a painful death by immolation. Drifting into the Eye of Terror, after seeming ages, Fabius's vessel happened upon a long-ruined crone world known as Urum. Besieged by the battle-scarred traitor legions, as the need for skilled apothecaries was at its greatest need, Fabius cloned several mutated warriors in exchange for resources to further his own projects. Horus's long war would suffocate without the retrieval and reintegration of the Chaos Space Marine's precious gene seed, and none were more qualified to extract and reimplant such genetic materials. Assuming command of the Emperor's Children Legion with their abandonment of their Primarch Fulgrim, the fortress of the Canticle City on the demon world of Harmony would prove a fitting bastion for Bile to continue his work. Furthering his works first started with the cloning of Ferus Manus, the spider continued to unravel the mysteries of the Emperor's greatest works of gene crafting. Creating a genetic copy of each and every one of the Primarchs of the Imperium, his finest creation would be that of the War Master. Stealing Horus Lupercal's body from the world of Malium, should the Champion of Chaos once more unite the tattered fragments of the traitor legions, a chance to dethrone the Emperor may still yet be accomplished. Confronted by the former first captain of the Sons of Horus, Ezekiel Abaddon, the reprisal of the returned pilgrim of the 16th Legion would be swift. assaulting Harmony with the founders of what would become his accursed Black Legion. Abaddon, whilst wielding the weapon of his genefather, the Talon of Horus, did slay the returned Warmaster. Destroying Fabius's clones to prevent them from upsetting the balance of power which he would claim for himself, Abaddon the Despoiler took his rightful place as the new Warmaster of Chaos and begrudgingly spared the life of the Clone Lord. Hunted by the now fractured Emperor's children, Craftworld Eldari, and even the Phoenician, Bile had no choice but to evade capture and bide his time upon the world of Urum. Never again would Fabius be a pawn of the warlords of the traitor legions, for his purpose was of greater import than any would-be conqueror of the void. Cloning himself into several copies, Bile's consciousness, regardless of his death, would live on within his replicas and prove to be a sufficient means to survive the millennia to follow. Truly independent as a free agent renegade, Bile's endless ventures of scientific discovery were now unconstrained by a single vessel. Fabius was now Legion, and with no limit to his sadistic and amoral experiments, several apothecaries flocked to learn the secrets he so meticulously guarded. Forming the Consortium, this band of misfit apothecaries pledged loyalty to their mentor as the near-unkillable Primogenitor set his eyes to the future. Regardless of his perceived freedom to venture unfettered across the void, many old compatriots attempted to sway the Spider to their cause. Oleander Co, a former pupil of the Third Legion, requested aid from Bile to unite the Emperor's children into a Legion once more. Unknowingly facilitating the plots of the Eldar during the shattering of the Craftworld, Luganoth of 764.M34, Fabius bristled at the manipulations he had endured and further determined to stay beyond the influence of the wars of the legions. Studying under the tutelage of the Homunculi of Komara, following his capture by the Drukhari during 796.M37, the Coven of the 13 Scars reveled in the Monki, who displayed such promise for their sadistic arts. Aiding them in the construction of the Tower of Flesh, a fortress made of the remains of those who had defied the Coven, the runes carved into its walls and injection of elixirs made by Bile prevented the sentient structure from perishing. Enriched with knowledge never before imparted to a so-called lesser species, the teachings of the Homunculi of the Coven would be imparted by Fabius to his fellow Emperor's children kin. Angered by the Spider's unsanctioned teachings, during the Battle of Belial IV of 993.M37, the Coven slaughtered Bile's pupils and surgically altered the Spider's brain to prevent him from ever uttering the secrets he had learned. Not content with such debased and vile transgressions of ethics, another clone of the Primogenitor would venture to the Blood Angel's homeworld of Bile. Reeling from the impending assault of the Tyranid menace, Lord Commander Dante required a means to fend off the Great Devourer, to which the Spider would exploit. Under the guise of the Mechanicus Magos Biologus, Haran Serpens, Fabius infiltrated the fortress monastery of the Arx Angelicum and convinced the apothecary Sasus to steal a vial of Sanguinius's blood for use in cloning a new breed of space marines. As chaos erupted with the creation of the Fell Blood Fiends, Fabius spirited himself from Bile with the vitae of the Great Angel. Hounded by the Blood Angel Sergeant, Rathan the Ready, under orders from Lord Commander Dante to achieve vengeance for the desecration of the Red Grail, the Spider began his study of the blood of Sanguinius. Rathan and his Flesh Terror's allies located the laboratory of the Clone Lord upon the world of Deinicus V within the Ghoulstar's region of space. Infested with the Tyranids, Fabius had managed to modify a zoanthrope of the species to prevent them from overrunning his facility and its many prison cells. With the capture of Rathan, the Blood Angel quickly found the fortress to contain several imprisoned space marines of numerous chapters, and in his escape attempts, would confront the Spider. Revealing his plans to clone a perfect copy of the Master of Mankind by identifying and reverse engineering the vitae of the Great Angel, Rathan the Ready would not stand for such obscene heresy committed by the Spider. Managing to slay Fabius several times and rallying the Astartes within to revolt against their oppressors, as the final copy of the Clone Lord stood atop the facility now besieged by the Great Devourer, the Scion of the Ninth achieved his vengeance. Retrieving the blood of the Great Angel and casting Fabius's body to the Tyranid swarms below. Though the spider would perish, many replicas, including his own purest form, continued their duties far from the conflict. For what is the destruction of a life's work to a being who transcends the bounds of mortality itself? The toil of the true inheritor of the spider's psyche had continued to spread mutations across human settlements to burgeon his debased new men, and in the latter millennia of the Dark Imperium, continued to heighten his acts of heretical dabbling. Capturing members of the Custodian Guard and Sisters of Silence during the War of the Spider, his pilfering of the Death Guard relic, the Arcona Contagious, evoked the wrath of Typhus the Traveler and his allied warband of the Shriven. Exploiting every side of the battle, Bile managed to conduct tests on the Golden Host and Null Maidens before returning to Urim to analyze his findings. For 10,000 years, the Primogenitor had sired more children through his surgeries and experimentations than any mad genius of the Void. Strangely, for such a debased renegade, with ancient age, the spider grew fond of the notion of his mutated breed of abominations seeking out refuge in the dark corners of the Void, and one day rising up as the next stage of humanity's legacy. Paternal to a fault, Fabius sought a means to assure his creations would live on, and continued to strive for a method to secure their thriving. Observing the Primaris Space Marines with piqued curiosity, the creations of the Archmagos Dominus, Belisarius Call, must be studied to uncover the methods used for their ascension. Not wanting to create mere chaos-corrupted simulacrums of their stature, the spider required a pure subject to carry out his schemes of replicating their gene-forged superiority. Having already cloned a perfect body of his own Primarch, Fulgrim, yet allowed it to be traded to the Necron Overlord, Trazin the Infinite. Despite his meticulous plans to redeem his Legion and their Genesire's legacy, it had all ended in failure. Though untainted by chaos, the clone of Fulgrim still retained the flaws of ego and genetic memories of his past actions as a pawn of the ruinous powers. Despite wishing to atone for its sins, the clone would not be allowed to further upset the balance of galactic unrest and would therefore be imprisoned within the Infinite's gallery of Solemnus. Knowing in his heart that Fulgrim would once again descend under the path of madness, only his new men could be salvaged as his own enduring legacy. Invading the Archmagos' vast flagship, the Zarquisator, during the Indomitus Crusade, Fabius, though seemingly seeking out the Sangprimus Portum, the genetic materials of the Emperor's Primarchs, sought a different prize. Alpha Primus, the prototype from which all Space Marines would be derived, had originally been an experiment to create a Primarch-like being from the Magna Mater genetic materials. Extrapolating backwards from his genetic code, such rich mutagenic materials would be valuable beyond measure to the Primogenitor. Ambushing Alpha Primus and extracting his progenoid glands from his body, Belisarius pleaded with the spider to not end the life of his most cherished son. Sharing a mutual respect for their own genius and stature as gene fathers, Bile allowed such a request to be abided, and once finished extracting the vital organs, retreated from the fray. Now equipped with bountiful knowledge and invaluable samples to implement within his new men, the Clone Lord's millennia of toil are close to their ultimate fruition. His fate destined to perish to the Blight, Fabius strives to complete his great works before his mind and body is ultimately claimed by his affliction, in order to bring forth a new era for mankind.
"You are Fabius Bile, if I am not mistaken,"
said Call. Bile turned from the object. The servo skull's eyes lit up Bile's with a red, infernal glow. "My reputation precedes me." He stood and moved on to something else that caught his eye, passing through a fragment of an Indranu null field generator mounted on a block. How Call had come across the artifact and what significance it had once held for him, he had no idea.
"You are the original, the genuine Pater Mutatis, not one of his clones."
Bile shrugged. "Does it matter? They are me, I am them. Genius is all. Kor let out a bark of laughter that boomed through his maxillary shield.
They say I am arrogant. Not unfairly, I suppose. But I think I may have met my match in that regard.
As Kor talked, he tasked one of his subminds to put a trace on the incoming hololith. Even though the signal had now come to a focal point, tracking it was surprisingly difficult. The feed was thin, weak, still scattered by the Avernus siblings' endless stellar bickering. Only clever modulation of the frequency allowed it to carry enough information to transmit Bile's semblance into the museum. One thing was sure, if Bile was using hololithic means for communication, he must be close. For a moment, Kor considered activating a shipwide alert, but decided that might well cause his unexpected guest to withdraw. Despite his misgivings, Kor found himself wanting to hear what this notorious heretic Astartes had to say. Bile smiled.
I am arrogant. What genius is not? I am a genius like you. A wise man acknowledges what he is good at. You will find no false modesty in this room, I think. But he also acknowledges his failings. Acknowledgement of one's talents cannot be accompanied by blindness to one's shortcomings. Otherwise, the wise man is not wise at all.
How very humble, said Kor.
Humility is a virtue most of those born in our era neglect, Archmagos. I would venture that you have little time for it yourself.
Little,
Kor said.
I find humility gets in the way of my self-belief.
Bile pulled a thoughtful face.
Take my friendly advice as one scientist to another. You should embrace humility. You should look within yourself with complete honesty. You will be better for acknowledging your fallibility.
I never said I was infallible.
You believe you are, though, said Bile,
reaching out with a phantom hand and speculatively passing it through a glassite case and the broken skull inside.
Take your great work, your Primaris Space Marines.
Bile bent low, peering into the skull's empty eyes.
I admit that I was excited to see the work of this supposed genius. You, I mean.
I got that. Thank you.
Kor had enough of a handle on the transmission now to begin to follow it, but it was heavily encrypted. He set to work breaking the codes.
What did you think of my work, as one scientist to another?
Said Kor, mocking Bile's words.
I found it disappointing, said Bile.
He had a hard face, with nothing of kindness to it.
I found little of interest, Kor. I have examined your work exhaustively. It is nothing revolutionary, merely variations on the same tired old theme. Muscle-swollen super soldiers, bigger, stronger, more annoyingly self-righteous.
He gave a sneer and moved on to a crystal claw thrusting up from a plinth. The light of his projection glittered through the transparent material.
Calling the Primaris Space Marines an improvement might be technically true, but you cannot truly improve upon a flawed design.
Bile continued to pace around, his phantom passing through cabinets and display plinths.
I did what was required, said Kor.
He was irked at Bile's criticism. The Primaris Marines were a masterwork. Could he not see? He pushed the emotion aside. Why should he feel stung by the words of this monster? His wounded pride was disrupting the work of his subminds tracing the Lifercast.
You probably did. That stiff old bastard Gilliman probably loved them. But you and I...
Bile dropped his voice to a conspiratorial whisper.
We are genitors of rare repute. We both know you could have done better.
Perhaps.
Come now.
Bile stood up straight.
It is a poor craftsman who only delivers what is expected of him. An artist aims to exceed, always.
You understand, I only had 10,000 years.
Are you mocking me?
More myself,
said Kor.
I had to design a whole new suite of weaponry, armor, vehicles, and equipment to go with them. If we're going to be fair to me, which I think we should be, the Lord Primarch wanted an improvement upon the designs of his creator. That is what I gave him. I think, under the circumstances of my commission, that last request rather trumped any benefit to me showing off any supposed artistry I may or may not have. Don't you agree? I have seen the results of your art, Bile. You're not a scientist. You're a torturer.
Bile turned, glowing. Doubled eyes upon the Archmagos, suddenly angry.
You are naive. You believe I have turned to chaos?
He shrugged, his temper just as suddenly gone, or at least hidden.
I suppose that is understandable. It is also not true. These gods my old brothers talk endlessly of, they are a sickness, a discordant note that destroys the harmony of the music of the spheres. There are no gods, Archmagos. There is only time, and being, and thinking things that brew themselves up and out of the two.
That's a way to look at it,
said Kaul. I am sure it would surprise you to learn that all I wish to do is what you wish to do.
Which would be?
Come now, said Bile, shaking his head. I want to save humanity.
A fine sentiment for the man in the manskin levers,
said Kaul.
Most of the time when people want to save people, it's not to add them to their wardrobe. If I'm not mistaken, you have been associating with the traitors that threaten to plunge your entire reality into an endless hell for the last 10 millennia.
Kaul stalked around Bile, rising up over him on his motive carriage.
You have bolstered their armies. You have aided their schemes. When you have not contented yourself with only abetting them, you have led them yourself in war against humanity. Your name is a byword for terror across hundreds of worlds. Wherever you go, your surgeon's knife is red with the blood of blameless folk. I have files of the things you have made from the living tissue of Imperial citizens, slaughtered civilians, populations tortured into new, grotesque forms. I have this sickening feeling that you are pleading innocence with me. I am astounded.
Kaul leaned in.
Yes, yes, astounded. You are a monster.
Bile looked up with a condescending smile.
I have been called monster before, and by people that would surprise you. Look at yourself. Do you think you would not give any child nightmares?
I am not pretty. But I'm nothing like you,
said Kaul.
No, you are not. You are not as good as I am.
Bile began to pace again, gesturing with torment.
I vivisected one of your creations. More than one, actually. But this one sticks in mind. He was ancient, almost as old as you or I. He was taken from a world far from Terra.
He made a show of musing.
Kidnapped. That is the word for what happened to him. Ripped from his family without his permission. Experimented on for millennia. Thousands of years of pain to be turned into a living weapon. Ha! You call me a monster. We are both monsters, the pair of us.
If I am a monster, then I am a monster on the right side of history,
said Kaul.
I say the same, Bile laughed loudly. There is no right side. There is no good and bad. Only two forces. Equally bad as the other, locked in a death spiral, the Imperium is as rotten and degenerate as the followers of Abaddon are.
Then why do you help them rather than us? You could have used your talents for good.
What do you think I am trying to do?
Bile scoffed.
What do you think would have happened if I had come back to Terra after Fulgrim left? Would they have been there to welcome me with open arms, to hail my genius? My contribution to humanity, they would have shot me. If I had come back later, after Horus's failure, then they would have burned me alive instead. There's progress for you.
If I have my history correct, and please note, this is a rhetorical question, then I would say balderdash,
said Kaul.
You spent hundreds of years leading the fallen children of the Emperor willingly.
And? You serve a moribund empire ruled by a corpse that feasts upon the souls of his subjects. There is no justice. There is no kindness. We are at the mercy of false gods on all sides.
Bile moved on to another exhibit.
Oh, I can see where this is going,
said Kaul.
This is the part where you tell me you wish to free us from all gods. By what? Replacing them with yourself?
I have been worshipped as a god, said Bile evenly. I found I have no taste for it.
I have heard this song before.
I have had enough in my life with those who speak in nothing but dramatic metaphor, snapped Bile. Songs, legends, no more. Will call. It is will that will save us, not stories.
He held up his hand and clenched it.
My will. Your will. I know you want to stop all this, to drive chaos out, as do I.
Now the evil genius declaims his plan. You are a cliché in a horrifying coat.
Bile bared thin grey teeth.
I have nothing to lose by telling you what I need, Kaul, or what I wish to achieve. I have everything to gain. Humanity is weak and imperfect. As we exist now as a species, we are finished. Don't argue with me on this point. You machine priests spend your lives trying to mitigate the frailties of our kind. Many people, the Emperor included, have invested their time in creating superior strains of humanity. None of them had any success.
Until now,
offered Cool.
There's a surprise.
I labored long to create a better race, one that would not fall to chaos, that would not prey endlessly upon its own. For centuries, I attempted this, until, weary, I became tired of it. I, Fabius Bile, became bored.
Well,
said Cool.
You have my sympathy there.
I became bored because I made a fundamental mistake. I believed that I must control everything, that only I could save the galaxy. I became disillusioned, knowing that was impossible. I abandoned my children, cruelly. Some of what you say is right about me. By good fortune, it was the best thing I could have done. Since my reawakening, I have become aware of my new men again, and they have changed.
He began to speak quickly, enthusiastically.
You should see them, Cole. They are perfect. They are resistant to the lure of the powers of the warp, physically mighty, invulnerable to age and disease. Their societies are egalitarian and just. All know their place and are satisfied to fulfill their role. I have seen what they have made of themselves, and I am humbled. I know now that the greatest creations must be like children, molded by their maker, but not finished. The greatest creations finish themselves. I have cloned every Primarch, Cole. They have all failed. If I were a more arrogant man, I would say that this is certainly the fault of the original material, and not my methods. But I must accept the possibility that I did not have all I needed to create a Primarch successfully. The error lay with me.
You still want to recreate the Emperor's sons?
Cole said. He wished to keep Bile talking. The algorithms employed by his subminds were steadily chewing through Bile's encryption. Deep in his core, he witnessed their unlocking as streams of numbers that turned green, and thereafter gave up their secrets. He was homing in on Bile's location, somewhere within the Avernus system, in the direction of the galactic core. He would not be far. Could not be.
I did, Bile answered. It doesn't work. The first I made were mewling imbeciles, but I got better. I, like you, am still a believer in the ancient methods of discovery, and through observation and elimination, refined my experiments. It got to a point that the last few I made were perfect copies in every way. So perfect, they had all the flaws of their originals, including being attracted to the bright flame of damnation. I've come to believe the Emperor's creations are irredeemably touched by the warp, even your beloved Lord and Master.
Then you don't mean to repeat the exercise. You wish.
Cole thought a moment.
What do you wish?
He held up a finger.
Aha, that's it. You wish to change the direction of your researches. Not make your own Primarch, but make something better. A being of your own design, yet similar potential.
You have sight, said Bile with a small bow of his head. I am human. I am imperfect. The Emperor's mistakes rot my body still. As many times as I have cheated death, I will not live forever. My new men require leadership if they are to take the human race into the future. They need help to survive. I wish to make a king worthy of them, something that avoids all the errors the Emperor committed.
That is an intriguing plan,
said Cole gravely. An impish feeling was rising in his gut, not helped by Bile's increasing earnestness.
Despite the simplicity of what you have achieved with the Primaris Marines, I admire the elegance of your solutions. You are undoubtedly a genius, Cole, but you are a generalist. I am a specialist. I have knowledge and experience that you never will.
Possibly,
said Cole. Bile did not perceive the growing twinkle in Cole's eye.
Definitely, said Bile. No one is limitless in ability. If you give me what I desire, you will have played your part in saving mankind. Think, Cole. The Necrons, the Tyranids, the Orcs. Chaos is not the only existential threat this galaxy faces. We are too weak as we are to survive. Do not let humanity perish at the hands of its myriad foes. Aid me. Let us put an end to these wars. All these space marines and temples to uncaring gods. These empires.
Bile swept his hand dismissively through the air.
These are the labors of lesser men. True scientists like you and I know the value of the great celestial machine, the variety of life and purpose to be found in the stars, even if you believe your God is behind it and I do not. Mankind can and should be the pinnacle of existence. Let us rise above it all. Help me bring peace. Give me the Sangprimus Portum, and you will be remembered as a benefactor of a new era. Your name will live forever, enshrined in memory, a great hero to our species.
Kor looked at Bile, eyes round with surprise. Bile's hololith looked back at him expectantly.
Well, what do you say?
As one scientist to another, said Bile again, and he held out his hand.
Let us cooperate.
This has been a tale of the Great Imperium of Man, read by the Remembrancer. The web cast by the Spider of the Third continues to exacerbate the well-made plans of gods and men. His genius countered by arrogance and a lack of human decency, Bile's quest for scientific innovation cost the lives of billions upon the altar of hubris. It is no failure to understand one's limits, and though exceeding them is commendable, must never breach the bounds of excess. Strive to better yourself and those around you, yet always be mindful that the path to damnation is not paved by malevolence, but well-intentioned acts of progress, which sacrifice morality.